And I'm now recording, and this is week two. Today is October 15th. And this is Applied Linguistics for Interpreters. And I don't want that. And I want to be able to have Panopto acquire. I think Panopto is acquiring. Yes, it says acquisisci PowerPoint, abilito di acquisizione, like that. It does look like it is also recording the slides. Right. So the background readings in the Paul Warren Introduction to Psycholinguistics book are actually two chapters that deal with producing language. And the chapters are called Planning Utterances and Finding Words. So this pertains to spoken language production and is intended to try to account for spontaneous production. What we do when we, not when we prepare the speech necessarily, but it accounts for extemporaneous production. So basically, what do we do when we have a thought in our head and we want to communicate this thought via language? Okay, so encoding it in an utterance in Italian, English, Swahili, sign language, it doesn't matter. So what happens in a speaker's mind and all of the steps from a sort of cognitive point of view. So in this class, we're focusing on the cognitive factors. And that's not to say that there are other important factors, but there's a special lens on what happens, let's say, in our minds. And we said that we don't have to have overt speech to, in fact, have language production, right? And we said that in English, there's two terms that are helpful because we have a word for language, linguaggio, and we have a word for speech, which is actually articolazione o eloquio. Quindi la parte più motoria, l'articolazione vera e propria, che può essere parlata, segnata o manuale. Okay? So that would be in Italian. I would say eloquio is the term that corresponds to speech. And finding words has to do with the fact that, in fact, you actually do have to find words in your mental lexicon, in any language you speak. And when things go smoothly, you are not aware of the fact that you're actually finding them. You realize that you're, in fact, finding them when something goes wrong. Like, for example, tip of the tongue state. Okay, so when you know there is a word, but you temporarily cannot access it. And that's not a sign of anything wrong with you. Okay, it doesn't mean you have dementia or you're like impaired. It's a normal aspect of how language works. Why? Because it's a very complex task. You're looking for things, it's kind of like looking for socks in a drawer, right? And there's lots of socks that could be like potentially good to wear, okay? And you have to pick the right ones. So these are the topics of the chapters we're going to sort of cover today. And I'll throw in, you know, things that come from additional studies, but you can find an outline of what we're talking about. I'm following sort of the topics that Paul Warren introduces. So planning utterances. Well, how do you study this? Right. So we said that there's two classes, broad classes of approaches to studying this. One is observational, observing behavior in naturalistic contexts. For example, recording. We could audio record today's lesson and then painstakingly transcribe everything, turns, pauses, etc., reformulations, and try to glean information about what happens. So we can use observational methods, and those are observational methods are typically high in terms of ecological validity. You're observing a human behavior in its natural, complex environment. And so there are advantages.
Good morning.
Yeah, it's still morning. It's still AM, okay? So we're all here now. You were on the train. Who was on the train? Okay. All right. I empathize. The train delays. So we've only just started talking about the important things. So. And then we also said that there's an interesting window on production, which comes from analyzing the constraints on speech errors. And we'll talk more, we'll see speech errors in abundance, okay? But because there are different types of speech errors and different types of speech errors that correspond to different stages in the planning process. There's a broad distinction, a very rough distinction, between errors that are sort of word-level errors that seem to obey semantic, meaning relationships. Either you say a word that's a synonym or an antonym, meaning the opposite, or a word that is a blend. So that sort of reflects the going from an idea to finding the word. Okay, that's one type of error. And those tend to happen at a distance. So words that can be several words apart in a sentence. And then another class of error comes from errors that involve phonologically encoding. That's the stage, invisible stage, when in fact speakers are assembling the sound units, the syllables, and the internal elements in syllables. And those tend to be phonologically related errors. Okay, so like switching one sound with another sound, anticipating, perseverating, so sound level units. So sound level units tend to occur in words that are close by, typically within the same syntactic phrase. And the fact that you have these two classes of errors, semantic on the one hand and phonological on the other, and that they correspond to different planning stages, is what in fact informed early hypotheses about how language, the cognitive, I'm going to throw in some of the jargon now, cognitive architecture for language production. Okay, so if you talk like a, you know, sort of psycholinguist, the cognitive architecture for language production means what happens in your mind when you speak. If I were to reformulate that when I'm having lunch with my friends who study engineering, well, you might say cognitive architecture, because they might actually understand cognitive architecture. But, well, what happens when we speak? Okay, and that's a useful exercise to reformulate, say things in other words. Okay, so the technical term and then the easy, understandable, plain language version. Are you all familiar with plain language? Plain language? What is plain language?
Linguaggio
semplice. It's not so much standard, so we'll talk about plain language. So plain language actually has to do with accessibility. So saying things in ways that are not, for example, too difficult. So plain language means everyday language, but it also means in a way that anybody potentially can understand it. Okay, so in Italian it would be lingua facile, although lingua facile is also sometimes even more simplified, right? But it's a good exercise to reformulate and to be able to say things in ways that are not, you don't need to be an expert to understand. Did you, you look like you have a question.
Yes.
Yes.
I just wanted to ask you, both patterns and speech errors are just two examples of observational methods, or are the main observational methods?
Those are the, let's see. There's, so for this particular stage in planning utterances, people have looked at pauses. Okay, so, but you, depending on what you're interested in observing, so you, if you want to look at conversation, you would talk, you would look at turn taking, for example, and you would look at, you know, units. So for this specific, to understand how people plan utterances, people have looked at pause patterns and speech error corpora. That's, yes. And these two methods fall under the rubric of observational methods, which in general pertain to how you would, you know, study language production. And then we said that sort of experimental, applied linguistics and experimental psycholinguistics have developed specific experimental methods to get at those questions about timing, like millisecond timing or time course. Like, then you want control. You want to know what the effect of frequency is. You need to study frequency, for example. You want to know what the effect of syntactic complexity is in a task. You need to zoom in on that factor. Okay? So the combination of ecologically valid, rich observational methods and experimental methods, the combination actually gives you the whole sort of data set that people use to study language production, language comprehension, and in cognitive approaches to interpreting and translation, they have very much imported these methods. So some of the papers that I selected that look at how interpreting works use very, very, very controlled experimental methods. Like, for example, the visual world paradigm, where you hear something and you're given a display that has potential targets that either interfere or match or mismatch, right? So these methods are used in a particular angle in interpreting and in interpreting studies. Okay, and then we said you can also do this. You can do it with a computer, just asking people to read words, translate words, interpret words. Decide whether a word is a word or not, right? Do all kinds of tasks, linguistic tasks, with linguistic material. Or you can look at what's the effect of having just seen something or heard something on how I interpret, produce, comprehend, translate, interpret, and so on. I mean, interpret, I meant ambiguously. Interpret, like, what's the meaning of something? So interpret has two meanings. One is to interpret into another language, but also interpret the meaning of something in one language. Okay? So, yeah.
Is just me or the echo in this class is maybe it's just me.
Is it bothering you? There is a little bit of an echo. I think it's something to do with the fact that there are no that it's a, you know, sort of largish room. There are no curtains. There's nothing that absorbs sound, and that's kind of annoying. I don't know if you want to try and sit. No, not at all. Maybe if you come up here, and there's a bit of a hum that comes from the projector, but I, let's see what we can do. Yeah. If it's a little bit better, but feel free to move around. If not, we could probably try opening the window, but then we'd have another source of noise outside. But it's reverberating. The door would make it worse, though, because sound waves bounce. That's, so you need something that absorbs, and usually you can do it by putting drapes or something that absorbs acoustic energy. So if I close the door, it will be bouncing all over. Yeah. Don't worry. Okay, so we're going to listen to an audio file that's actually made available on the Warren, Paul Warren book. So now you're going to listen carefully. And the idea would be you would transcribe it, and then transcribe the pauses. But we won't do that. But we'll just listen to it, okay?
If I were to complete the program, the breaking class or none or
Okay, degraded input. Can you tell what accent it is?
I couldn't hear
anything.
You couldn't hear anything.
See the slides.
Perfect. Perfect. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.